Good day, class. So for this last installment of our lessons on meteorology, we shall study clouds, how clouds are formed, and how are they classified. Plus, we will go into the details of the different types of weather fronts, and we will cite some examples of extreme weather. Okay, so let's start now with clouds. Now, technically, clouds are condensations of water and other particles like dust particles or ice particles in the atmosphere. So, everybody, kindly take a look at this diagram. So, it is the sun that drives the formation of clouds. So, the sun heats up bodies of water, and the liquid water, upon heated, is converted into vapor or gaseous form. Now, as the water vapor rises in the atmosphere, it reaches the so-called dew point in the atmosphere. So, the water vapor begins to condense and forms clouds. Now, clouds are classified based on the following. So, clouds are classified according to their height or altitude above and their appearance from the ground. So, let's go now into the details of how clouds are classified. So, in terms of altitude or height, clouds are classified according to the following. So, first, we have to call the high altitude clouds. So, high altitude clouds are made up of ice crystals such as cirrus clouds, cirrocumulus clouds, and cirrostratus clouds. Then we have the middle altitude clouds or alto. These middle altitude clouds are made up of water droplets and ice. Okay, examples, we have alto cumulus and alto stratus clouds. And finally, we have the low altitude clouds or strato. These low altitude clouds are made up of water droplets like cumulus clouds and stratus clouds. So let's take a look again of how clouds are classified according to altitude or height. So we have the following. We have the so-called high altitude clouds. So, these clouds are made up of ice crystals. So, examples, we have cirrus clouds, cirrocumulus, and cirrostratus clouds. Then, we have what we call the middle altitude clouds. These middle altitude clouds are made up of water droplets and ice crystals. And this includes the alto cumulus clouds and alto stratus clouds. And finally, we have what we call the low altitude clouds. These low altitude clouds are made up of water droplets. So that includes cumulus clouds, stratus clouds, and nimbus clouds. So that's how clouds are classified according to altitude or height. Now, clouds are also classified based on their appearance. Okay, let's take a look at cirrus clouds. Now, cirrus clouds, these are high altitude clouds, and in terms of their appearance, they are generally wispy and feathery in appearance. And cirrus clouds often produce mares or tails that are tail-like wisps of ice crystals. Now, usually the appearance of cirrus clouds indicates good and fair weather. Now, what about cumulus clouds? Now, cumulus clouds, these are low altitude clouds which have flat bases and are often described as puffy, cotton-like, or fluffy in appearance. And the word cumulus comes from the Latin word cumulo, which means heap or pile. Now, cumulus clouds are quite popular because these are the clouds that we drew when we were kids. Cumulus clouds are the clouds that we all drew as kids. And again, in terms of their appearance, cumulus clouds are cotton ball in shape or popcorn-shaped clouds. And these are the clouds in the opening scene of that famous cartoon, The Simpsons. Okay, so let us now proceed to the next type of cloud called the stratus clouds. Now, stratus clouds, they are heavily layered and they often appear in sheet-like formations. Now, from the word strata, strata means layers. So if you will take a look at some of these pictures of stratus clouds, again, you will notice that these clouds are heavily layered. So these are the so-called stratus clouds. And finally, we have the so-called nimbus clouds. Now, the word nimbus comes from the Latin word meaning rainstorm or cloud. Now, nimbus clouds, these are clouds that produce precipitation that reach the ground in the form of rain, snow, or hail. Now, everybody kindly take a look at this picture. So, the clouds that you see in this picture are nimbus clouds that brings rain, snow, and hail. Now, everybody, I want you now to zoom in on this special type of cloud called the cumulonimbus cloud. Now, cumulonimbus clouds, these are dark clouds with anvil-like tops. Now, kung familiar po kayo sa shape ng anvil, ang Tagalog po ng anvil ay taluktok. Flat po yung top niyan. Ito po yung pinagpupukpukan ng mga namamanday. So, ito yung gumagawa ng kutsilyo or espada. And flat po yung top niyan. So, these clouds, as you could see in the picture, they have anvil-like tops. Again, this is due to the shearing by very high altitude winds. And what is so special about cumulonimbus clouds is that heavy turbulence, violent rains, thunder and lightning are often associated with cumulonimbus clouds. So if there are cumulonimbus clouds in your vicinity, then expect thunder and lightning or expect heavy rainfall in your vicinity. Okay, so isn't that fascinating about clouds? So before we move on to weather fronts, let's watch this fascinating video about clouds. So everybody, let's watch this.
We see them in the sky nearly every day, but what are clouds? How do they form and what do they mean for our weather? Clouds are composed of billions of tiny water droplets, and your average cloud is roughly a cubic kilometer in size and tips the scales at around 500 metric tons. The cloud stays aloft because, believe it or not, it's actually lighter than the air around it, because the water droplets are spaced so far apart that their density is comparable to air. So it comes down to comparing the molecules. And since water molecules are lighter than oxygen and nitrogen molecules that make up over 99% of the atmosphere, the water floats. Now, clouds form as warm, humid air rises and cools, and the water vapor condenses out onto tiny particles in the air. And there are several types, named based on their shape and their altitude. At the lowest level, there's cumulus, which form in fair weather. There's also stratus and stratocumulus, which can produce a bit of rain or snow. If the cumulus clouds pile up and reach for the sky, though, this tells us that stormy weather is brewing, and these can develop into enormous, towering cumulonimbus clouds that are responsible for thunderstorms and sometimes even worse. At mid-levels, we have altocumulus and altostratus, which tend to indicate that some kind of active weather is probably on the way. When altostratus turns a dark gray and produces continuous rain or snow, it's then called nimbostratus. At high levels, there's wispy cirrus, cirrostratus, and cirrocumulus clouds, which typically form due to a nearby warm front. When these conditions prevail, we can also see persistent contrails, which are artificial clouds produced in the wake of jet engines. Even higher are stratospheric nacreous clouds that are associated with the Antarctic ozone hole, and the highest are the mesospheric noctilucent clouds, which form as water vapor settles out onto meteoroid dust from space. Now, we may have skipped fog here, but come back for episode 8, when we take a close look at the different kinds of fog and how they form, as we all become a bit more weatherwise.
Now let's go into the details of this weather phenomena known as weather fronts. Now when we speak of weather front, a weather front basically is a boundary separating two masses of air of different densities. Now when we speak of air of different densities, we usually think of cold air and warm air, because we know for a fact that cold air is denser than warm air. Warm air is less dense. And this is the cause of weather phenomena outside the tropics. So we have what we call a cold front and a warm front. Now, to further explain the concept of a weather front, so basically a weather front is a boundary that separates two different air masses of different densities. So when we think of air masses of different densities, we think of cold air and warm air. Now we know from our previous lessons that cold air is denser than warm air. So cold air sinks and warm air rises because warm air is less dense. Now when these two air masses of different densities meet, then the boundary separating the cold air and the warm air is called a weather front. Now there are two types of weather fronts. We have a cold front and a warm front. Now let's take a look at a cold front. Now what happens in the cold front? Now in a cold front, a cold air mass may force its way under the warm air mass, like a snow shovel wedging its way under a pile of snow. Now in a cold front, the cold air moves under the warm air, because we know that cold air is heavier, cold air is denser, so the cold air moves under the warm air. Warm air is less dense, and cold air is denser or heavier, so the cold air moves under the warm air mass. So the boundary between this cold air and warm air is what we call a cold front. So let's take a look at this illustration to further explain what happens in a cold front. So in a cold front, there is meeting between cold air and warm air. So you will notice that the cold air is in a collision course with the warm air mass. Now, since the cold air is denser, the cold air is heavier, and warm air is lighter or less dense, so the cold air moves under the warm air, as you could see in this diagram. So the cold air moves under the rising warm air. And we know that warm air packs a lot of moisture. So as the warm air moves upwards, clouds form and it brings precipitation or rain. Now the boundary between this cold air and warm air mass is a cold front. And we know what to expect in a cold front, since there is that rising warm air. That rising warm air packs a lot of moisture, and that would lead to the formation of clouds. Clouds would bring precipitation or rain. So that's what happens in a cold front. So again, as you could see in this illustration, the cold air is in a collision course with the warm air. Now, since cold air is denser than the warm air, the cold air moves under the warm air. And when that happens, the warm air begins to rise, and that rising warm air carries moisture, and that moisture will lead to the formation of clouds. and clouds would bring rain and precipitation. So what do we expect in a cold front? Well, in a cold front, we expect rainfall because the cold air moves under the rising warm air. The warm air carries moisture, and that moisture would trigger the formation of clouds. Okay, let's take a look at this animated illustration of how cold fronts are formed. So as you could see, we have here cold air represented by the blue arrow and warm air represented by the red arrow. So the two are in a collision course. The cold air is in a collision course with the warm air. Now, since cold air is denser and heavier than the warm air, the cold air moves under the warm air. So the warm air rises, carrying with it moisture. And this moisture will lead to the formation of clouds, and clouds would bring precipitation. So that's what happens in a cold front. So isn't that fascinating about cold fronts? So in a cold front, there is a collision course between cold air and warm air. And that boundary where the cold air and the warm air meet is a cold front. Now, since cold air is denser than the warm air, the cold air moves downwards. So this will lift the warm air. And that warm air, as it moves upwards, it brings moisture. Moisture would trigger the formation of clouds, and clouds would bring precipitation. Okay, so that's what happens in a cold front. And that rising warm air, as it meets with the cold air, that creates a low pressure area. And you know what that means if there is a low pressure area. So that rising warm air is usually accompanied by a falling barometer. So that's a low pressure area. And that would lead to the development of clouds, specifically cumulonimbus clouds. And we know that cumulonimbus clouds would bring heavy rains and thunderstorms. So we associate cold fronts with heavy rainfall and thunderstorms. And on a weather map, those triangular shaped symbols, they represent a cold front. So every time you see those triangular shaped symbols, you know what to expect. So a cold front usually leads to the development of cumulonimbus clouds, and these clouds bring heavy rainfall and thunderstorms. Okay, so what about warm front? Now, a warm front forms when a moist, warm air mass slides up and over a cold air mass. And as the warm air mass rises, it condenses into a broad area of clouds. Now, a warm front brings gentle rain or light snow followed by warmer, milder weather. Now, to further explain what a warm front is, let's take a look at this diagram. So, basically, what a warm front is that we have warm air and cold air. Now, you will notice that the warm air and the cold air, they move in the same direction, in contrast to a cold front wherein the warm air and the cold air, they are in a collision course. But in a warm front, the warm air and the cold air, they move in the same direction. And since warm air is less dense than cold air, the warm air slides up and over the cold air. And as the air rises, that warm air brings moisture, and moisture would lead into the formation of clouds, and clouds may bring rain. Okay, so let's take a look at this diagram to further explain what happens in a warm front. So in a warm front, you will notice that the warm air and the cold air mass, they move in the same direction. Now, since the warm air is lighter or less dense than cold air, the cold air mass is denser. So what happens is the warm air mass overtakes the cold air mass, and the warm air mass slides up and over the cold air mass. And as the warm air rises, that triggers the formation of clouds, and clouds would bring precipitation. Okay? And on a weather map, this is how we represent a warm front. So those semicircles on a weather map, that represents a warm front. Now that is really interesting and fascinating about weather fronts. So we have cold fronts and warm fronts. So before we continue, let's watch this fascinating video about weather fronts, cold fronts, and warm fronts. So let's watch this.
Blue spiky lines, red bumpy lines, we see these on our weather maps all the time. But what are these fronts, and what do they mean for our weather? As the atmosphere flows around the planet, it tends to do so in large air masses, each of which has fairly uniform conditions of temperature and humidity. It's at the boundaries between these air masses that we find weather fronts. If a cold, dry air mass pushes into a warm, humid air mass, we have a cold front. And as the colder, denser air advances, it forms a steep wedge that forces the warm air in its path upward very quickly. Clouds form right at the front. This typically produces very abrupt, sometimes very intense active weather. If a warm, humid air mass pushes into a cool, drier air mass, we have a warm front. With warm air overtaking cooler, denser air, the warm air is forced upward but at a much gentler slope than with a cold front. This produces widespread cloud and precipitation along the front and just ahead of it. And as the warm, humid air flows further up that gentle slope, it results in mid-level clouds ahead of the active weather, cirrus clouds far out in front. We don't necessarily need moving air mass.
So I hope that's clear about weather fronts. Now let us proceed now to a detailed discussion of precipitation. Now when we speak of precipitation, we think of rain, snow, hail, or sleet. Now in order for precipitation to form, cloud droplets must grow in volume by roughly 1 million times. And when these cloud droplets grow and they become heavier, they fall to the earth as either rain, snow, hail, and sleet. Now, meteorologists has an explanation for the formation of precipitation, and they call this the Bergeron process. Now, the Bergeron process is a theory or an explanation that relates the formation of precipitation to supercooled clouds, freezing nuclei, and different saturation levels of ice and liquid water. So, to simplify the Bergeron process, let's take a look at this diagram. So the clouds must be supercooled, and when you have supercooled clouds, you have the formation of tiny ice crystals. And because of the very low temperature inside the clouds, these ice crystals, they attract water droplets. So these ice crystals, they grow bigger by attracting or stealing moisture from the cloud droplets. So these ice crystals, they grow bigger and heavier until they come to a point that they are heavy enough to fall back to the earth as either rain, snow, hail, or sleet. Now, the Bergeron process explains the formation of precipitation. So again, in order for precipitation to form, supercooled clouds must be present. And inside these supercooled clouds are tiny ice crystals. Now, because of the very low temperature inside these supercooled clouds, these ice crystals, they tend to attack or steal cloud droplets. And as they attract these cloud droplets, these ice crystals, they grow bigger and heavier until they come to a point that the ice droplets are heavy enough so that they fall to the ground as either rain, snow, hail, and sleet. Okay, so let us now proceed to the forms of precipitation. Now, the type of precipitation that reaches the Earth's surface depends on the temperature profile in the lower few kilometers of the atmosphere. So these are the following forms of precipitation. So first, we have rain and snow. Now, in meteorology, the term rain means drops of water that fall from a cloud and has a diameter of at least 0.5 millimeters. Now, if the temperature outside the cloud is warm, then those ice crystals that would fall from the cloud would melt and they would reach the ground as rain. But if the temperature outside the cloud is low, then these ice crystals that fall from the cloud, they will not melt and they would reach the ground as snow. Now, other forms of precipitation includes the following. So first, we have sleet. Now, sleet is a form of precipitation consisting of ice pellets often mixed with rain or snow. Then we have hail. Hail is produced in cumulonimbus clouds and they fall to the ground in the form of hailstones. These hailstones, they begin as ice pellets that grow by collecting supercooled water droplets as they fall through a cloud. So sometimes these hailstones, they can be as big as baseballs. And they can do a lot of damage to automobiles, they can break windshields, they can do damage to property, to roofings of houses, and they can even hurt people. Alright, so take a look at this picture. So the background there, that sleet, they are ice pellets, and that guy is holding hailstones. Hailstones, they can be as big as baseballs, like the one in this picture. So these hailstones, they can do damage to property, they can break automobile windshields, they can damage the roofings of houses, and they can even hurt people. All right, so those are the forms of precipitation. So before we continue, let's watch this fascinating video about precipitation and the forms of precipitation. Okay, so let's watch this.
I'm Kenton Jewicki. Today we're going to learn about the four different types of precipitation. You may not know this, but high in the sky where our clouds are, it's very cold. And so even rainfall, a lot of the time, starts off as snow. But then the atmosphere is so warm that it, of course, melts the snow. And then at the surface, we end up with just rain, liquid water. But what if the ground is freezing at the time, but it's actually warm up above it? Well, then the rain is going to freeze rapidly at the surface as it reaches the surface. And that's why we call it freezing rain, because that's when the ice forms as the liquid water freezes on contact with the surface. And if we add a little bit more cold air just above the surface, rain is still going to freeze fairly rapidly, but we're going to get a little bit closer to snowfall. This is what we call sleet. It's going to be slush or even ice pellets as well. So not necessarily snow, but not freezing rain either. It's that in between. And this can, of course, also create slick conditions on roadways. And then if the atmosphere is completely frozen over, then the snow never melts. And then down here at the surface, we end up with
snow.
How does
hail form? What a great weather whiz kid question from Barbara Morgan STEM Academy. I went to see the second graders on Monday, and I'll be asking lots of questions throughout next week as well. And that was, how is hail form? Well, it's an interesting question because typically people think, well, if ice falls from the sky, shouldn't that be during the wintertime? Well, not necessarily the case. In fact, most likely it is in the summertime because thunderstorms have to form. When you get lots of heat rising, that air rises and it cools, like we talked about in the water cycle there. Air cools and condenses and makes the clouds. If you have rapid updrafts here, very strong updrafts, it takes water, the water droplets that are falling, and then it pushes it up to where it's colder, and there's very cold air aloft in here, and so temperatures are below freezing, and you start to get ice forming. The ice crystals continue to grow and then cluster together, and you can get clumps of little hail sticking together to make big hail balls, and the stronger the updraft, the more it can hold, the more weight it can hold, and so the hail will get larger basically by the stronger the storm system is. And so eventually the hail gets so big that the updrafts just cannot handle it, and gravity takes over and the hailstone comes down to the ground. It could be 80 degrees and ice could be falling from the sky when that happens. So typically here in Idaho, we're getting hail that's like this. You see here maybe a half inch hail, pea-sized hail. This is fairly typical hail, and that comes from a pretty strong storm. But we have had some large hail here. This is not a picture from Idaho. You can see how wide this hail is, about 8 inches. One of the biggest hailstones ever recorded here. Lots of little hail all clustered together. But we did have hail this size up in Cascade with one of those storms that moved through over the summer. Great question from Barbara Morgan STEM Academy, and more questions to come this week.
So I hope everything is clear about precipitation. So I guess we can now proceed to the difference between a hurricane and a typhoon, though we have already mentioned this in our previous lessons. Now, if a storm was to form in the Atlantic or in the Eastern Pacific Ocean, then we would call it a hurricane, like in the United States. Storms in the United States, they call it hurricane. Now, a typhoon is generally any storm that begins in the Western Pacific Ocean. So that includes us in the Philippines, Taiwan, and in Japan. So a storm that threatens Japan or the islands of Guam or the Philippines or Taiwan, the storm is called a typhoon. Now, winds from a typhoon usually are stronger than a hurricane. However, they endanger far less land area due to their location. Okay? So anyway, we have already mentioned this in our previous lesson about typhoons, cyclones, and anticyclones. So in the Northern Hemisphere, a cyclone, or in the Philippines, we call it a typhoon, they spin in a counterclockwise direction. Okay? Storms formed in the Eastern Pacific Ocean, they call it a hurricane. But storms formed in the Western Pacific Ocean, we call it a typhoon, like here in the Philippines. So we call our cyclones typhoons. Okay, and if you will notice, the typhoon spins in a counterclockwise direction. Again, this is due to the Coriolis effect. Okay, in the Northern Hemisphere, typhoons spin in a counterclockwise direction. Now, that is really fascinating about cyclones, hurricanes, and typhoons. Anyway, they refer to only one thing. In the Americas, they call it a hurricane. Here in the Philippines, Japan, Taiwan, and Guam, we call it a typhoon. And in India, they call it a cyclone. Now, cyclones, typhoons, and hurricanes, these are centers of low pressure. And you know what that means? A low pressure area is always associated with bad stormy weather. And kindly take a look at this satellite photo of a typhoon. So you will notice that the typhoon spins in a counterclockwise direction. Since the typhoon is in the Northern Hemisphere, typhoons, hurricanes, and cyclones in the Northern Hemisphere, they spin in a counterclockwise direction. Now, storms in the southern hemisphere, like this in Australia, you will notice that the storm spins in a clockwise direction. Cyclones in the southern hemisphere, they spin in a clockwise direction. Okay, so isn't that fascinating indeed? Okay, and another noticeable feature of cyclones, hurricanes, and typhoons would be the so-called eye of the storm. Now, the eye is a zone of scattered clouds and calm, averaging about 20 kilometers in diameter at the center of a hurricane or a typhoon or a cyclone. So, ito tinatawag natin na mata ng bagyo. And inside the eye is an area of calm. So, there is little wind inside the eye of the storm. Now, surrounding the eye is the eye wall. The eye wall is a donut-shaped area of intense cumulonimbus development and very strong winds that surrounds the eye of a hurricane or a typhoon or a cyclone. So, yung eye wall, ito yung paligid ng mata and malakas po ang hangin dyan. Okay, yeah, very strong winds and the development of cumulonimbus clouds. Alright, so that's the so-called eye of the storm. Now, let's talk about tornadoes. Now, tornadoes, these are violent wind storms that take the form of a column of rotating air, which we call as a vortex. And this vortex extends downward from a cumulonimbus cloud. So what I'm trying to say is that tornadoes, they originate from a cumulonimbus cloud. And tornadoes, they take the form of a rotating column of air. All right, so everybody kindly take a look at this diagram that will explain the formation of tornadoes. Now, you have warm air that rises, and this warm air carries a lot of moisture. So, this warm, moist air rises from the ground, and that warm air meets with the cold, dry air in the atmosphere, creating a vortex which descends from the cumulonimbus cloud. And this vortex eventually comes into contact with the ground, and an updraft takes place. This updraft draws in more air, and this air rises while it is rotating. And as the tornado spins, it creates a destructive force in its path. So tornadoes are really destructive indeed. Now, to further understand the formation of tornadoes, let's watch this video about tornadoes and how tornadoes are formed. All right, so let's watch this.
Call me the tornado chaser. When the wind is up and conditions are right, I get in my car and follow violent storms. Crazy, you say? Perhaps, but really, I chase these sky beasts to learn about them. I want to share with you what I know. Tornadoes are rapidly rotating columns of air that form inside storms, then connect with the ground via a funnel of cloud. When that happens, they tear across the earth, posing a huge threat to life and property. Because of this, there's a great deal of research into these phenomena. But the truth is, there's still a lot we don't know about how tornadoes form. The conditions that may give rise to one tornado won't necessarily cause another. But we have learned a lot since people first started recording tornadoes, like how to recognize the signs when one is brewing in the sky. Are you coming along for the ride? Tornadoes begin with a thunderstorm, but not just any thunderstorm. These are especially powerful, towering thunderstorms called supercells. Reaching up to over 50,000 feet, they bring high-force winds, giant hailstones, sometimes flooding, and great flashes of lightning, too. These are the kinds of storms that breed tornadoes, but only if there are also very specific conditions in place. Clues that we can measure and look out for when we're trying to forecast a storm. Rising air is the first ingredient needed for a tornado to develop. Any storm is formed when condensation occurs. The byproducts are the clouds. Condensation releases heat, and heat becomes the energy that drives huge upward drafts of air. The more condensation and the bigger the storm clouds grow, the more powerful those updrafts become. In supercells, this rising air mass is particularly strong. As the air climbs, it can change direction and start to move more quickly. Finally, at the storm's base, if there is a lot of moisture, a huge cloud base develops, giving the tornado something to feed off later, if it gets that far. When all these things are in place, a vortex can develop, enclosed by the storm, and forming a wide, tall tube of spinning air that then gets pulled upwards. We call this a mesocyclone. Outside, cool, dry, sinking air starts to wrap around the back of this mesocyclone, forming what's known as a rear flank downdraft. This unusual scenario creates a stark temperature difference between the air inside the mesocyclone and the air outside, building up a level of instability that allows a tornado to thrive. Then, the mesocyclone's lower part becomes tighter, increasing the speed of the wind. If, and that's a big if, this funnel of air moves down into that large, moist cloud base at the bottom of the parent storm, it sucks it in and turns it into a rotating wall of cloud, forming a link between the storm that created it and the Earth. The second that tube of spinning cloud touches the ground, it becomes a tornado. Most are small and short-lived, producing winds of 65 to 110 miles per hour. But others can last for over an hour, producing 200 mile per hour winds. They are beautiful, but terrifying, especially if you or your town is in its path. In that case, no one, not even tornado chasers like me, enjoy watching things unfold. Just like everything, however, tornadoes do come to an end. When the temperature difference disappears and conditions grow more stable, or the moisture in the air dries up, the once fierce parent storm loses momentum and draws its tornado back inside. Even so, meteorologists and storm chasers like me will remain on the lookout, watching, always watching, to see if the storm releases its long rope again.